Hi, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, and good morning to everyone tuning in live to our Ivy webinar today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ellie. I work with Ivy, and we are the leading software and community for designers. Designers use Ivy to create and send proposals and tear sheets, invoice clients online, track and bill for hours, and tasks on the go with our new mobile app, send POs to vendors, manage FF&E schedules, and much more. Together with various industry experts, Ivy hosts webinars for designers to learn more about the different ways you can manage your business more efficiently and profitably. So today, I'm very excited to welcome Preston to the Ivy webinar stage. Preston is the showroom manager of Sun Lighting Tucson and the director of training for the Sun Lighting Companies. He's an ALA certified lighting specialist and an Ivy CEC certified provider. And he's taught numerous classes about lighting around Arizona and at Dallas Market during Lightovation. He's a frequent guest on home improvement shows in Arizona and has published a number of articles and publications around the state about lighting and design. So today, Preston will be teaching you about all things sourcing wholesale versus sourcing retail, which we know you designers want to know a lot about. So he'll be presenting for the next 45 minutes and we'll answer all of your questions at the end of the presentation. So if you have any questions, please make sure to click the Ask a Question button and we'll be running through as many questions as we can towards the end of his presentation. So without further ado, I'm happy to welcome Preston to the Ivy webinar stage.
I'm glad to be here. Thank you guys. So I wanted to do this presentation to kind of give you some insight into you being able to buy stuff, whether wholesale or retail, understanding the differences there and, you know, how you can basically get the best price for yourselves. What is the definition of wholesale? What is also the definition of retail? We're also going to talk about building relationships with your suppliers and why that will give you a competitive advantage going forward. And I wanted to be able to give you some ideas on how you could price some of your design work to make sure that you put the most money back into your own pockets. Moving forward here. There we go. So, wholesale pricing is actually an ambiguous term that is often used when discussing price. Really, when we're thinking about it, these aren't really just set in stone when it comes to pricing structures. Oftentimes, there's different pricing structures that can be used when we're talking about wholesale. A lot of times, as suppliers, we have different pricing, different wholesale pricing that we get from manufacturers. And we're going to be talking about that as we go forward here, how we can go ahead and make sure that you are paying the best price for products as you're going forward. Well, one of the things that we got to keep in mind, though, is wholesale pricing is very ambiguous. Now, a lot of times we'll see it thrown around when people are talking about it. You'll hear it oftentimes, come on down and you'll get the best price from us. It'll be wholesale. You'll hear a lot of times in retail applications as well, where they're saying you can come on down and you can pay what we pay and things of that nature. We'll get into a little bit more on that as to how you can know you're actually getting that best price. We also want to know that retail pricing is also a very ambiguous term. That is actually a pricing structure that's designed so that it's something that can be given to the end user. These prices are actually designed most of the time to be able to offer slight discounts, things like sale prices and whatnot. But really, typically, when we're talking retail versus wholesale, what we're talking about here is with retail, we're talking about something that the end user, that your customer, can end up paying. So even if they join some type of buying club and they're able to get a discount, as if your end user can pay that same price that you would pay, that would be considered a retail price. Whereas wholesale is a pricing structure that's not available whatsoever to your end user. So when we're talking about wholesale pricing, some factors that go into determining that would be the size of the job. It would also be the number of the items that are needed for the job, the type of job, whether it's a residential or commercial. And we also need to know that the pricing structure for this might mean that if there's one item needed, you might not get the same price as you would for 50. With that being said, things that you want to look out for when you're looking to buy wholesale is having a conversation with your suppliers and finding out what type of wholesale structure they're purchasing from. For instance, I can speak to our industry, which is lighting. As a lighting distributor, there are some different structures that are available to us. You have basically like a designer price, something that we can all purchase from. We have distributor net, so it's something where, you know, this is what they'll say that everybody can purchase. We have stocking distributor net, so there's some different structures that we can purchase from. This is a conversation that we need to make sure that we have designers and suppliers to find out what is the pricing structure that us as suppliers are purchasing from, so that we can make sure we pass along those discounts to you. So with that being said, we want to make sure that as you go forward, that you're building a relationship with your suppliers. You want to understand that the building this relationship with your supplier, you have an advocate, somebody that is able to work with you on any issues that might arise on a job. Issues such as back orders, defective items, warranty issues, and compatibility. So again, speaking about my industry right now with LED lighting, there's a lot of people that want to be able to purchase it, want to be able to dim it, and there's compatibility issues there. Having a relationship with a supplier that can answer those questions and can see things for you before any problem arises is something that you want to make sure you have. You want to understand that this relationship that you have with your supplier is going to be one that should be a mutual partnership. When you build this relationship, you're building with somebody that has a vested interest in seeing you succeed. They will be able to help you stay on top of the newest trends in the industry. They'll also be able to notify you of additional opportunities for training. They'll be able to basically be another person in your office that will help you to design a good job. So some tips for maintaining a good relationship with suppliers is you want to talk to your suppliers regularly. This is key. Making sure that you are having this conversation in terms of what is going on in the industry, talking to them about what type of pricing structure are they purchasing on so that you know what you would be getting. You also want to make sure that you address any concerns between you and your supplier as soon as they arise. This is something that I see a lot of. The best relationships are one where there's complete and total transparency and honesty. And with a lot of our designers, I see this a lot where we can converse, we can talk, we can make sure that the project is going forward as best as possible. And that's what you want to create with your suppliers. You want to make sure that you refer any damaged or faulty goods to them as soon as possible. The quicker that they're notified that there's a problem, the quicker they can jump on it and get it resolved for you. You also want to make sure that you pay on your accounts as soon as possible. I can't stress that enough. This goes to building that trust. You want to make sure that you're getting the best pricing available, but you also want to make sure that you're working with these guys to see to it that, you know, everything is above board. One suggestion I have is to avoid rush orders wherever possible. And they can cause a lot of stress with your business and put a strain on that relationship. You end up, you know, needing a product right away, and your supplier is trying the best to be able to get that for you. And we really don't want to try and stress our relationship out. We all know that at times that is absolutely 100% necessary, but if at all possible, try to avoid it. And again, going back to the transparency and honesty, letting your supplier know why you need it, when you need it. Be prepared to review and renegotiate the terms of your relationship with the supplier from time to time. This would be a good time to ask the question as to what is, you know, going on in terms of the pricing structure and making sure that you yourself are getting the best price possible. Again, with some of the different tiers that are available, you can, as a designer, can actually help a lot of your suppliers to be able to get much better pricing. It's a collaborative effort. It's something where if you know a particular line or something that a supplier can open up and help you to be able to get, this would be something that bring to your supplier as an additional opportunity for them, but also for yourselves. And as you collaborate, you know, we can go ahead and make sure that as a group, that we're getting the best possible price from manufacturers. So one of the big reasons I want to see relationships between suppliers and designers is a real world example of a designer that I personally worked with and a friend of hers. So designer A purchased from a supplier due to the cost alone. And because of this, the designer was looking to be able to put a greater markup on it. However, this designer did not have a contact person that was dedicated to them at that particular supplier. Whereas designer B purchased from a supplier they had worked with on numerous projects. They did pay a slightly higher cost, but this designer was able to work with the same contact person that she had worked with on previous projects. Designer A ended up getting the item arriving at her office free of charge. There was a special, there was no freight charge on the item that she purchased. Designer then took the item to her client's home for installation, and upon opening the box, it was discovered that there was some damage and therefore the item couldn't be installed, and the designer then ended up taking the item back to her office. Designer B had the item arrive at the supplier's office, and the supplier was then able to deliver the item to the customer's home. Same issue, they upon opening the box, they found there was some damage and it couldn't be installed, so the supplier took the item back to their office. Designer A ended up contacting the supplier, and she was told that she would have to fill out a requisition form that would allow her to send the item back. She was also informed at this point that freight needed to be paid going back because the free freight deal was only good for the item coming in, not necessarily for items going back. She was also told that the RMA department would be able to review her claim and get back to her within 7 to 10 business days as to whether or not they were going to be able to, you know, resolve the issue. Designer B was notified by the supplier that they had contacted the manufacturer, they ordered the new item, all the associated paperwork with the RMA department and everything else was taken care of completely and totally by the supplier. Designer A then hears back from her supplier that her claim was accepted. After 5 days, she heard this, but she couldn't get her new item until the receipt of the defective item back at the supplier. So the designer then ships the item back to the supplier. Whereas designer B received a call that the replacement item will be here in 3 days and there was going to be no additional charge to her, considering it was a defective item, and the supplier was able to actually get the manufacturer in this case to expedite the shipping. Designer A received an automated email stating that the item was returned successfully and would be shipping out after inspection of the item, to determine what the cause of the damage was, and that the new item would be sent out as soon as that process was complete, which would be in another 7 to 10 business days, and the designer needed to pay the freight for it to come back to her. Designer B had the supplier receive the new item after 3 days, and they delivered it for installation on the job. Designer A, the item finally arrived at the designer's office after 8 additional days. The designer delivered to the job site for installation 2.5 weeks after the discovery of the damage. The designer had to pay double the price on a freight for it to go back and for it to come back to her. And there was no contact person for her to speak to in regards of trying to recoup some of the cost of all of that. Designer B had a customer that satisfied the problem was resolved for 4 days, and they were able to get the replacement item. The designer hears from the contact person was anything done better in regards to dealing with the issue, and no additional cost was taken on by the designer. This is why the relationship is important. The relationship with your suppliers is one that can help you have that advantage, because as we see in this real world example, oftentimes when we're just looking to be able to just purchase on price alone, we might be able to get that extra bit of a discount, but it's associated things that might come up. Even down the road, a warranty issue that creeps up on you after a year or so, your supplier will be able to help you work through that. And this is, again, something I can't stress enough. The relationship between you and the designer will help you with that competitive advantage. It's a peace of mind. It's a security blanket. It's insurance. That if something does happen, you have somebody that can work on the problem so that you as a designer can then focus on what it is that you're passionate about, which is the design work and moving on to another project. Sometimes the advantages of a good relationship with suppliers offsets any difference in price that you might pay. With that being said, understand that the relationship that we have with this with the suppliers is something that we should not be afraid to ask. What are you paying for this item? What type of pricing structure are you at? And how does this relate to me? How does this help me? So, what is the best way to be fairly compensated for your design work? Well, there's really no easy answer on that. Whether you choose hourly, product margins, flat fee, square foot, or any type of hybrid, you know, a lot really does depend on your experience, type of client that you have, the project, your specialty, and thousands and thousands of other factors that go into that. There are three rules that you need to keep in mind when pricing your work. You want to lay everything up front. You want trust between you and your client, and that's absolutely essential. And don't ever underestimate the value of your experience. So laying everything up front, clients need to completely understand the process and the amount of time involved with each phase of the project. You want to have a well-defined scope and clear parameters regarding what they can expect from you and what you can expect from them. Oftentimes, if you're upfront and letting your clients know just what the scope of the project's gonna end up entailing, how much work's gonna have to go into it. Again, you're not dismissing your skill set. You're not dismissing your experience. You're reminding the customer of why they came to you in the first place. Trust between you and the client, again, is essential. It's an assurance that your skill in collaborating with the client will result in a space that they absolutely love. If, for some reason, though, after a comprehensive consultation, it seems like the client's so uncomfortable with your pricing structure, or maybe even second-guessing recommendations, you might want to consider whether or not the job is worth the time and stress of constantly having to defend your work and your costs. Again, this, to me, it goes to not underestimating the value of your experience. Whether it's through the education, training, experience, or just a natural born talent that others don't possess, myself included, you're in this business because you have a level of expertise that the marketplace has been demanding. So never, ever sell yourself short. Some different pricing options. You can charge by the hour. You can do a flat fee. You can do a cost plus fee. You can do a percentage-based fee, a fee based on square footage, or a retainer fee. By the hour, this can really be applied to the initial consultation phase. This allows you and the customer to decide whether or not it's a good fit. This is still the interview process for the beginning stages of this project. You know, and this fee that you would charge by the hour really depends on the experience level of the designer. And for customers that might be worried about what the overall cost would be, there can be a maximum design fee, maximum hourly rate, basically, that you know that you won't go over, that you and the client agree to. Something then that customer's not expecting any additional charges at the end of that. You can also do a flat fee. However, this is most common where you have a designer that's able to focus on a particular service that, you know, has done this numerous times. It can easily estimate the time and the cost with which will be involved with the project. And a fixed fee can actually give a, you know, peace of mind to clients who are very worried about that. They know going into it what it's going to cost. You also have a cost plus fee. If you specify and order products for your clients, you can use a cost plus method for calculating the item's final price. So you're basically adding a small percentage to compensate you for your services and time. Now, again, with your relationship that you build with your supplier, if you know that you're getting the best possible price from your supplier, you know that your supplier, as selling you wholesale, is possibly getting the best price they can get from a manufacturer and pass it on to you, by adding even a small percentage, your customer still will see a net savings, no matter if they shop you or not. percentage-based fee is for really large design projects. This is basically you charging a total price, it's a percentage on the total cost of the project itself. This ensures that you will receive appropriate compensation no matter what happens on the job, as the job changes, as change orders are made, as things get larger and larger sometimes. This is making sure that you're covered with that so that you don't lose any time in terms of any additional time that you have to spend or any additional purchases that have to be made. We also have a fee-based structure based off of the square footage. This is something where if you're going into a new project, a new construction, and you're going to be selecting all the initial hardware, the flooring, fixtures, cabinetry, wall finishes, paint sample, everything, you're basically just charging based off of the square foot. And again, this the fee that you charge based off of that is, again, going to depend on your experience and even the size of the project in that case. And finally, the retainer fee. This allows you the option of having your clients retain your services. This is really good for those clients that like to come back and just ask your opinion on this particular couch or this particular paint color. Or it's not necessarily they're working on a large project, they just constantly are doing home improvements over the course of a long period of time. And this retainer fee allows you to be able to, charge for your services. And usually this is combined with like a cost plus percentage, so that way, as you make purchases for that, compensated again for your time and effort when you're doing the shopping and running around for them. So I guess we're going to open it up to questions here. Let's see if I remember how to do this.
Just go back to the crowdcast. Perfect.
There we are.
Okay, thank you, Preston. That was so informative. This is such a hot topic for designers. This is something that we all want to know, sourcing wholesale or retail. So that was great. Thank you so much. So we do have a few questions that have come in. So Lauren has asked, what are the advantages of working with a supplier who buys at the lowest volume discount from the manufacturer versus her as the designer buying direct at a higher priced designer or trade price?
Well, Lauren, one of the advantages of being able to buy from a supplier is going to be not having to take on some of the additional responsibilities that we spoke about in our real-world example there. You're also going to be able to be working with this person to, foresee any potential problems that you have coming down the road. Again, talking about my industry in particular when it comes to lighting, there are a number of issues that come up with compatibility where we're talking about line voltage versus low voltage items. But you as a designer really focus on designing and doing what it is that you're passionate about, your love. A supplier is going to be able to take care of all that mundane paperwork and stuff, which will allow you to basically stay lean and mean. Oftentimes, if you decide as a designer that we're going to take this on ourselves and we're going to start making these types of purchases, I've seen where design firms have to then hire someone that's just specializing in taking care of those kinds of things. So you're potentially adding into your overall cost in terms of running a business at that point by hiring somebody that's just going to have to take care of that kind of stuff for you that the supplier would automatically do.
Makes sense. Be great. Thank you. So we have another question from Kathleen. How often do you recommend staying in touch with their rep? And when do you have new product to show us if we're not at markets?
Well, as we all know, there's multiple markets that go on throughout the year, but I usually recommend staying in touch with your supplier or your rep at least once a month. And giving them a call and just asking, what is the latest thing going on in particular industry. Again, for lighting, I know we have two major markets, both in January and in June in Dallas, and there's associated markets where a lot of the same product can be seen, more on a regional basis. But definitely keeping basis is something that you should be looking at. And with the relationship that you would build a supplier, the supplier should actually be reaching out to you on a monthly basis.
Great. Okay, that's very helpful. We have another question from Jordan. Is the fee structure options you explained value-based fee? Can you elaborate on how it's structured?
So on the fee structures, you're really taking into account your skill sets as a designer, what you specialize in. And again, like I was mentioning, don't underestimate your value. I myself, as somebody that works within this industry and sees a lot of pretty fixtures, I myself could not put two fixtures together and make them mesh well. I myself would end up needing a designer, and that's what somebody like you would end up coming to you for. So when you're pricing the value of your work, you join a trade association like ASAD or IVE and have these kind of conversations and find out in your area what are people paying for typical design services and look at your experience level, the type of jobs you've done. Creating a portfolio that'll help you be able to show your clients what it is that you can offer them can help you set a lot of that fee structure itself.
Great. So we have another question from Lauren. How do we ensure that the supplier is giving the best pricing, which would include extras like shipping?
So, Lauren, one of the things is having this conversation with your supplier, asking them what type of structure are they purchasing off of. As I mentioned, again, in my industry, there's a few options available to us as when we purchase lighting, and making sure that they're part of that, the lowest possible structure, and seeing what you possibly could do to help them get to that point. In our case, we call it a stocking distributor, would allow us to have the best price. But more importantly, making sure that whenever you receive a price on an item from your supplier, that they're including any and all associated fees. If there is a freight charge that has to be given, ask them if are they charging you directly what they're being charged? Are they putting any kind of markup on it? Is there any additional charges for any additional prices for, again, in my industry, a ceiling fan? Is that include the down rods? Does that include the controls and things of that nature? So everything should be clearly laid out when you're actually making that purchase. It shouldn't just be, hey, Lauren, this is the price you're going to pay for it. And then when you turn up to receive it, there's additional pieces that were needed for it that weren't initially told to you.
Got it. Great. Okay, we have another question from Ashley. She wants to know, she's seen that a lot of suppliers have multiple tiers of pricing. If so, how do you find out which level they're buying at? Is that something that suppliers will disclose?
If you build this relationship with a supplier, this should be a question you can ask them. If you can go to your supplier and say, I'm just curious, what type of pricing structure are you at? Are you getting the best possible price you can purchase this for? And if it's something that they come back and tell you, unfortunately, no, there is a pricing structure lower, then again, you can say, well, how can we affect that? How can we get to that point? Is there something I, as a designer, can do? Do I need to sell more of a particular product line, or is there a product line we can purchase from together? Having that conversation, don't be afraid to ask them. And again, if you have a supplier that's not willing to explain to you, they don't necessarily have to tell you what they're marking things up at. But you really do want to make sure that they're being honest and forthright with you and saying, yes, this is absolutely the best price I get. And you should be able to see that as well. When you're pricing it, you're check on them. When they offer you a price and say, this is the best possible price, this is the wholesale price that I'm going to be able to give you based off of my price, they you should be something where you can't find that price anywhere else any lower. So don't be afraid to question them, to hold their feet to the fire as well.
Great. That's great advice. Thank you so much, Preston. I think that's all the questions that we have today. This was so informative, and we're so happy to have you as our guest today on the IVE webinar stage. And we hope to have you back soon. So thank you, everyone, for tuning in. If you have any questions, feel free to shoot me an email. My email is ellie@ivy.co, and you can contact Preston. We'll be sending through a replay and via email for you guys to access this full live stream at your own convenience. And if you have any other questions about IVE or Sun Lighting, please reach out. Thank you so much for tuning in today. Have a great afternoon. Bye.
Thanks, everyone.